Hello and welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Broya and here are your local and national headlines for tonight. As we now focus on the recovery in our city, we look at how local businesses are getting back to work and adapting to the new reality.
So for the start of the news, we're going to be listening to Paul Taylor from Extinction Rebellion. He's going to be telling us about the cycle initiatives which Extinction Rebellion have been working on. We're then going to hear from William Ranieri, who's going to be speaking directly to Extinction Rebellion out on the streets of our city. So I'm joined here today by Paul Taylor from Extinction Rebellion. Welcome, Paul. We're going to be talking about the cycle campaigns that you've had in and around our city. We've had Guerrilla Cycle Lanes, and I know you've had another event recently. So just tell us about it and what you're trying to achieve there.
Yeah, we organised a bike lane celebration for the lanes, the temporary lanes that the council have opened on the Old Shoreham Road, the A270. And the idea was to use the lanes and bring it to the public's attention that they're there. They're there for use. So it was just one Sunday afternoon. We actually got 100 people to show up for it, which was nice. We cycled a couple of times around a loop up both sides of the Shoreham Road using the new paths. It was colourful. We had sort of coloured flags on the backs of the bikes, had a couple of bikes with a sound system strapped on, so it gave us a bit of a party atmosphere.
Always need a bit of music.
It always helps. Got people walking, passers-by involved and stuff, and everyone enjoyed the vibe, I think. So, yeah. It's good.
And the aim here, of course, is you want more cycle provision, cycle lanes, etc., in and around the city. That reduces the amount of cars and thus the amount of emissions. That's the end goal, isn't it?
Well, yes. We wanted to celebrate the fact that the council's already done that by putting this in place, albeit temporarily, and say, yeah, we like this and encourage it as much as we can from the council. Indeed, there are other routes in the city which would make it a lot easier for people to come in by bike. And obviously, if you've got a bike, if one person leaves their car at home, that's a benefit. There's more space on the road and there's less pollution and so on. So yeah, we're encouraging that as much as possible. And we're lending our support to the proposal that's in front of the council at the moment to consider how Brighton could become a car-free city or a people-friendly city, as a lot of places prefer to call it, by 2023. Make it more comfortable for pedestrians and cyclists as users of the city space, just like, you know.
And that's a big commitment, isn't it? Because I know the Greens and the Labour-led administration council, they want, that's one of their big goals, isn't it? Going forward. So just tell us about that commitment, a bit more about that.
Everyone
be aware of it, because I know it's driving a lot of policy decision making in a city.
Yes, the council has committed, I mean the government right at the top has committed to Paris Climate Accords, and that's got to filter down really through into all the cities and down to individual people one way or another. So Brighton for its part is thinking how it can re-envision the transport for the city. This will be one part of their plan, I'm sure. But their commitment is to make it carbon neutral, emission-free city by 2030. So this is the plan that they're considering at the moment is a part of that. That's the big picture behind it.
Yeah. Yeah. And why did you join Extinction Rebellion? I mean, it's an obvious question, but why did you get involved? Because a lot of people have done, haven't they?
It's great. It's attracting a lot of traction. I think we're all aware of what's happening with the climate. Yeah. The ice caps and glaciers are melting, and sort of the Arctic is on fire, and all the stuff we've seen in Australia and the States, and even here with the kind of increased energy and all the storms we get. And we know what is projected, and it's fairly scary and it's fairly urgent. So the reason I got involved was to do my little bit, whatever way I can, just put my shoulder in behind the wheel as well, as it were, and see what I can do to campaign to get the government to do something about it, do more about it.
Yeah, where can people find out more about Extinction Rebellion?
Yeah, if they just Google Extinction Rebellion Brighton, and you'll come up there. Also on Facebook.
That's got all the events on it, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has, yeah. And Instagram as well, I believe. So.
All right, we'll leave it there for now, Paul. Thanks for coming in. Speak to you again soon.
A pleasure.
Cheers.
Thanks for inviting me.
Thanks.
Extinction Rebellion put some brightly coloured markings on the road, Guerilla Bike Lanes in London Road, the Old Steen and Hanover, as a statement to carry on
the way that thing, you know, during lockdown, pollution dropped, bike travel increased. And we need to go in that direction rather than reverting back to, you know, normal, because normal is what caused the pandemic in the first place. It's not normal. And we need to rebalance. We don't want to be breathing car pollution. We don't want to be stuck in traffic. We'd like wildlife to have a fair chance. We need to engage a lot more with bike travel, where the car is not always dominant. And already, even as lockdown eases, the domination or the dominance of cars is already making quite a comeback. And so now is the time for the council to be brave, to be bold, to be visionary, to be forward-looking, and to not just pretend that this never happened and that we should all scuttle back to how things were, but to actually use this as a pivotal moment, in a really pivotal moment in our history, to redirect things for the greater good, so that we, that the new normal really is something new, where bikes are so far more prominent, given a lot more space on our roads, and where we're pedestrianised, where the centre of town is a lot more pedestrianised. Yes, lots more. Shops that make Brighton the distinctive and individual city that it is. And it's for people who need to load their cars up with shopping. There are lots and lots of sort of more out-of-town places for that. And there's also big car parks like Churchill Square. But really, we don't need enormous volumes of traffic clogging up the centre of town and places like Madeira Drive, which has just been clear, you know, that's been closed to cars for the duration of lockdown so people can exercise. It's fantastic. Emissions have gone down. We really don't want to see a spike in emissions again. We really would like this to be a turning point for the better. And it will, you know, we don't need to talk about the effect of pollution on people's health, because it's so well documented. Nobody enjoys sitting in traffic queues. Obviously, cars are a necessity for lots of people. It's not like don't have cars, ban cars. That would be, you know, not tenable. But it's just the expansion of bike lanes and the expansion of the bike as a valid way of getting around the centre of town. Bikes and buses, but more bike lanes. And so the Guerrilla Bike Lanes that Extinction Rebellion installed, that was a statement to say, please, council, can you carry on like this and keep going in that direction? Because that is what Brighton really needs.
So we're now going to hear from Olivia Marshall. She spoke to people down at the Volks Railway on Brighton Seafront, and here is her report.
Usually much more reliable than the Great British weather. Since 1883, Volks Electric Railway has been transporting locals and tourists along Brighton Seafront. But the coronavirus crisis has temporarily put the brakes on this much-loved seaside attraction, leaving staff here uncertain about when things will get back on track.
We're just sort of starting to hit now, June, July, August, are really busy months. So that's a shame. I mean, we miss having the passengers, we miss doing the job, we miss taking children up front with us and showing them the sights and letting them sort of see how happy they are. So that's a real shame. But obviously the primary concern is following the guidelines from the government, from the council, and then obviously keeping passengers and staff safe, which is the most important thing.
Under normal circumstances, the railway can carry up to 80 passengers down the 1 mile stretch of track. But with rules around social distancing here for the foreseeable future, the train will not be able to run at full capacity. While Volks are continuing to review government guidelines, safety means they are in no rush to go full steam ahead.
Well, with that, it all depends on exactly what the guidelines are. We would have to see those, and we do look at the guidelines regularly and we see how we can adapt. So if we were to open, and at the moment we don't have any knowledge as to whether that's possible, although we're always looking at it, we would be looking at possibly limiting the number of people on the trains to keep the social distancing. There would be, obviously, the PPE would be for all staff. We would probably, we may have to close the halfway station so we don't have people getting on if we've got full, you know, full train for social distancing. Mm-hmm. There's a number of things we would look at.
Having stood firm on our seafront for over 100 years, for those at the railway, there is no doubt that they'll be able to journey together with passengers again in the future.
I think the only thing is to sort of say we can't wait to see our passengers and our regulars back, and as soon as we can, we will be.
Olivia Marshall, latest TV news.
That's it for the first half. Join us for the second half for reports on the city recovery, a portrait artist, and if that's not enough, we get a game of mini golf. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Broya. Mark Walker speaks to the Conservative Councillor for the Hove Park Ward on Brighton and Hove City Council, Samir Bagaeen, about the economic recovery of our city. Here is what he had to say.
Park Ward, Brighton Hove City Council. Samir, where do you see the economic recovery of the city? Where do you see that starting to flourish a bit more? We've seen some shops opening up, the big being queued at. The supermarkets have been open throughout. Some of the takeaway places have opened up, but we need that wider opening up, don't we, for the city's shops, and that's going to happen 15th of June. Have you got an update for us?
Not much of an update, Mark, but it's good to keep an eye on the, if you like, all of the indicators and trackers for economic activity. And I think ultimately what's at the back of everyone's mind is the recovery and what shape that recovery takes. You know, across the country, it looks like it's going to end up being a tick-shaped recovery with a sharp V and then a slow, steady return back to, you know, what it was earlier this year. But that's not going to happen until the middle of 2021, it looks like. I was on a briefing this morning with the National Infrastructure Commission on what they're doing, if you like, to throw money at construction, building and everything else. So those are sectors that have come back, and they came back before, if you like, you know, the June 1st deadline and so on. They've been back for a few days. We need to look at the broader economic activity across the city. If I took a walk down St. James's Street and Western and North Street yesterday in the city centre, it's still way off, you know, what it was, I think, in terms of footfall and action, you know. And what we need to do is offer support to the shops that are putting in place plans to allow customers and people to go back, you know, in time for that June 15th opening, if it stays on track. You know, we are a visitor economy, we are a tourist economy, and we've got institutions. But if you're asking me, you know, should we ban visitors from coming into the city? I don't think that's practical or reasonable, given that we really need the economy to start moving again, our local economy, more importantly, to start moving again, so that we can then begin to quantify what sort of financial measures and what sort of incentives we need from government in order to make things stick, you know. And I think that's what you should.
Perfect. We'll leave it there. Samir, thanks for talking to us again, and we'll catch up again soon.
Thanks. That's lovely. Thank you, Mark.
Thanks.
So we're now going to hear from Nick Sayers, who is a portrait artist in Brighton. He's been drawing lots of different people, his neighbours, other people in different streets in Brighton during lockdown, and this is what he had to say.
So I'm here with Nick Sayers, an artist, a resident in Brighton, and you're also a photographer, Nick, aren't you? And you've been chronicling life of lockdown, really, for many people, how they're experiencing it by doing some drawings. I think it started off for people down your street, but now you've expanded it and you've got all these life portraits. Tell us all about it.
More or less, as soon as the lockdown started, I was kind of thinking, I'm an artist, come on, I've got to think of some sort of artistic project to respond to this unique sort of moment in history. And so I'd also been thinking I should sort of practice my drawing skills while I was in lockdown. And it's been something I've been sort of trying to sort of revive for the last few years, really. And it was just suddenly occurred to me 2 or 3 weeks ago that I could combine the two projects and draw my neighbours. And what I've always enjoyed about drawing portraits of people is you sort of sit down and it's quite informal and you can sort of chat to each other while I'm doing the drawing. And so it becomes a sort of conversation, an almost slightly sort of therapeutic sort of like encounter.
Can you show some of the portraits then?
So I've met everyone from, this is a visual neuroscientist who yeah. lives at the other end of the street. This is a teenager with her amazing sort of emo sort of goth fashion. This is another teenager who's had her sort of A-levels cancelled.
What you're aiming to do with this, I know you're raising money for the NHS charity, so tell us a bit about that.
My work has completely dried up as an artist because I normally go and work in schools and science events and sometimes sort of events and projects around the world. So all of which have completely gone completely. So it's partly to earn a living by doing portraits on other streets. But also, yeah, so 10% goes to NHS Charities Direct, so NHS Charities Together, sorry.
Yeah.
Which, yeah, obviously is an important charity at the moment.
Perfect, Nick. All the best with the portraits. I'm looking forward to getting mine, mm-hmm. me and my wife. Look forward to that.
Cheers.
And we'll catch up soon. Cheers, Nick. Thanks.
Nice one. Thank you very much indeed. Cheers. Thanks.
So we're now going to hear from William Ranieri. He played a round of mini golf down on Brighton Seafront, and here is his report.
As the lockdown eased, businesses restart their activity, bringing back life to our city. I went down Madeira Drive to check how the mini golf team is getting ready for the rest of the summer.
Golf is one of those activities that almost require 2 meters to be played.
It does, yeah. Obviously, we got the news a few weeks ago that they were thinking of reopening golf courses, but we knew that wouldn't apply to us because, you know, this is far, far smaller than the, you know, our links. But we spoke to the council, we spoke to the police, and they were happy with our arrangements that we're keeping everyone 2 holes apart. You know, that's usually in excess of 10, 15 feet. So, yeah, it's been good. It's been good to have people trickling back in. It's been great.
And so you guys have done some renovation on the golf course?
We are. I think some of them were a bit of, you know, we've been open for 6 years now and some of the carpets were the original ones. So we've had some lively new colours put in. I think it's looking good. We had to put the handbrake on a lot of this work right before lockdown. But it's good to get it underway now, ready for the summer.
So what are you guys expecting for the rest of the summer?
Hard to say. We're not expecting the summer that we would have done. But hopefully, you know, we've had a lot of people coming down very interested and very excited the fact that we're open and that there's something they can do safely outdoors. And the weather's been beautiful. So if it stays this way, who knows? It could be great. I mean, I'm actually hoping that the whole of Madeira Drive becomes reopening, becomes livelier soon, because it's a shame to see places like Yellow Wave still affected. As soon as this whole area is reopened, I think it'd be fantastic. I think it's worked fantastically during lockdown. I think it was a really good idea. I run and cycle along here myself, so I do appreciate that side of it. I do know that some businesses are affected by it, ourselves included to an extent. So it is a shame in that sense. I think it would be good if there was a compromise made, maybe in terms of redeveloping this place long term, that there was a happy marriage between being able to get people down here in vehicles and keeping it as a pedestrianised zone. So we'll see. Long term, I think that would be a good plan.
So we're now going to hear from Olivia Marshall again. She went down to Brighton Seafront to speak to the Brighton Dolphin Project, and here is her report.
Babies, and big ones. Oh wow, I blew a bubble.
Not exactly a sight many of us would associate with our shoreline. A pod of between 10 and 15 dolphins, including young, surprised this unsuspecting jet skier just a mile off the coast between Brighton and Shoreham. According to the Brighton Dolphin Project, sightings like this have become particularly common in recent weeks. And Andrew Schoon from the project says the beach is becoming the perfect place for a spot of dolphin watching.
Well, I mean, it's not something you would think of. don't often see them from here, but a number of the sightings we have seen at the beginning of this year have been from beach. It would be good for people to still be coming down and managing to see them, because it does instigate this lot of excitement too.
And while we've been spending more time indoors, sea life around Brighton seems to have been thriving. As well as dolphin sightings, one lucky beachgoer in Rottingdean spotted a grey seal enjoying the sunshine, and over in Chichester, a seahorse was sighted just a metre below the water. Early indications suggest that less human activity in and around the coast has encouraged wildlife, including dolphins, to move further inland.
It's hard to say definitively because of the research that we're doing. We have seen a twofold increase from last year. It could be that we have a better network, which is what we're trying to do, for people to send in our sightings, which we rely on heavily by the community. Aside from that, there should be fewer people out on the water. So the fact that we've actually had a double sightings recording with fewer people out there, it does seem to suggest that we're getting a lot more dolphins. Yes.
So if you are heading to the beach or taking to the waves anytime soon, remember to keep an eye out, and you might be lucky enough to experience a sighting like this. Olivia Marsh, your latest TV news.
That's it for today. Join us tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Good night. We'll be right back.